Hi folks, and welcome to the final part in our tutorial series on YARA. So if you've been following along this series, you've learned what YARA is, how to build a simple rule, how to scan the free UNPACME malware corpus using YARA, and the different scenarios in which YARA can be used and how that affects the type of rule that you develop. In this final part, we're going to talk about writing efficient rules. Now, if you're just starting out with YARA, there is a lot to learn about the syntax, the different types of strings and conditions, all that sort of stuff. So it's a lot to take in and also consider efficiency at the same time. But hopefully in this tutorial, we give you three just broad categories to keep an eye on when you're building YARA rules that will help keep your rules a little tighter and a little bit more efficient. Now, if you're seeing this, it's because you're watching this video on YouTube. So just a quick shill for our Patreon. If you like this kind of content, go check it out. With that, let's jump in. So when we talk about efficiency when it comes to YARA, mainly what we're referring to is how much compute power is required for a certain rule to scan a certain file. And what that translates into is the time taken to scan a file. So this actually depends on two different factors, one of which you control and one of which you don't, right? So the factor you control is the rule itself and how that rule is written. The factor you don't control is the actual data that the rule will be running on. So you have to make your best guess or best estimate when writing a rule on what kind of data the rule will be run on, and then hone the rule based on that. Because one of those factors is not in your control, you are usually going to have some amount of inefficiency, which you can't control in the rule. But again, we're just going to provide a few tips that might help you, in general, make your rules more efficient. So when starting to talk about rule efficiency, there's this great quote from Wesley Shields, one of the main contributors to the YARA project, in one of the GitHub issues on the YARA GitHub, which I think is fantastic. And I'm just going to paraphrase here. He says, "When thinking about YARA, I like to encourage people to think of YARA as a two-step process. The first step is searching for all the patterns listed in the strings, and the second step is evaluating the conditions." So what he's getting at here is you can't use well-formed conditions to make up for poorly chosen strings. So because the strings are scanned first and then the conditions are applied, if you choose strings that are very inefficient, and we'll talk about what that means in a minute, your rule is going to be inefficient regardless of how you set up the conditions. So it's important to consider both the strings and the conditions. Now, I'm not going to go too in-depth into how the string searching works. I'm actually going to link below. There's a much better description from a small post that Florian Roth put together on rule efficiency. I'll link that below, where he talks about how the string searching actually works. But the main things you need to know about the string searching is each one of the strings is broken down into atoms, and atoms are up to 4 bytes in length. The algorithm that selects the atoms attempts to get the longest and most unique atom out of the string. Once the atoms are pulled out of the string, the file that is being scanned is scanned for the atoms first. And anywhere where an atom matches, the algorithm then goes back and attempts to match the full string. So it's kind of like an egg hunter, if you think of like shellcode egg hunting, where you're searching for a little flag, and once you find that, then you search for the full pattern. I don't know if that's a good analogy, but that's generally how I think of it. Now, why this matters is because you can craft your strings in a way that gives this engine the best selection of atoms possible. So what we're going to talk about first is string selection and a couple rules that are going to help you select good strings for your YARA rule. So there are many different ways that you can tweak your strings to make them more efficient. And of course, you can hypermile your YARA rule to make it as efficient as possible. But there are 6 things that we think are broad strokes to keep in mind when you're selecting your strings. Number 1 is avoid short strings. Strings that are 4 bytes or 3 bytes or, God forbid, 1 byte long are incredibly inefficient. This is because these strings will occur multiple times within files that you don't intend to match on. And the shorter the string, the less likely to get a full atom out. So of course, if you have a 3-byte string, the largest atom that could be selected is 3 bytes. So avoid short strings wherever possible. The second point is just a variation of the first point, and that is avoid breaking hexadecimal strings into chunks smaller than 4 bytes or the largest atom. So of course, in hexadecimal strings, you can break them up with wildcards or with jumps. And because an atom can't be selected across a jump or a wildcard, only the concrete bytes between the jumps or wildcards can be selected for atoms. So creating sections of bytes that are smaller than 4 bytes makes that a very inefficient atom. There are some situations where you will not be able to avoid this. However, our advice is to at least keep one longer string in all hex strings, one string that is longer than 4 bytes, to allow for maximum efficiency. And the third point just tags onto that, that leading and trailing wildcards in hex strings are not required. There's no reason to add leading or trailing wildcards on a hex string. Of course, if you think logically about how the pattern matching works, it doesn't matter that there's leading or trailing wildcards, right? Those are going to be ignored when you're trying to match the string. If you need something like there needs to be 4 random bytes before a string, put that in your condition. Don't put it in the string definition itself. All right, number 4, there's some debate around this, but we believe you should avoid regular expressions. Regular expressions take some of the magic out of YARA, and poor regular expressions take all of the magic out. So what do we mean by this? Well, when you include a regular expression, the regular expression must be run on the binary, right? There isn't anything really magic that YARA can do to make up for the fact that that regular expression is going to have to be run on every single file that's scanned. There is one thing you can do, though, to make this a little bit more efficient. If you include a concrete string in your regular expression, preferably of 4 bytes or more in length, that string will actually be extracted as an atom and used to scan the file first and then apply the regular expression only where the atoms are found. This makes your regular expressions much more efficient. So our advice is use regular expressions sparingly. Only use them if you must use them. And if you must use them, include a concrete string of 4 bytes or longer so that the YARA engine has a shortcut way to find where it should apply the regular expression in the file, rather than having to apply the regular expression across the entire file. Number 5 is avoid strings that have a single repeated byte. Now this is pretty rare, but we have seen it before where there have been strings in YARA rules that are simply a bunch of zeros or a bunch of null bytes or some other repeating pattern of a single byte. Aside from short strings, these are the most inefficient possible strings, as the most efficient atom that can be extracted from that string is 4 bytes of the same character. And if you think about it, how often do 4 bytes of the same character occur in a file? Often, especially if they're null bytes. So our advice is to avoid strings that have long repeating similar characters. These strings are very difficult for YARA to search for efficiently. And our 6th recommendation here is to use the no case keyword sparingly. So no case will allow you to take a single string and match on any case variation of that string. But if you think about what this is doing logically under the hood, it's actually creating duplicates of that string for every variation of a capital letter in the string. So it's really n factorial variations of the string, where n is the length of the string. And if it's a long string, this can lead to a ton of different duplicates of the string and a lot of atoms that need to be searched for. So just keep that in mind. We use the no case sometimes when it's required, but use it sparingly when you have to. Okay, so that wraps it up for efficient string selection. Now let's move on to modules and a word of caution about modules. So modules are a very powerful tool that you can use to identify specific characteristics in certain types of files in YARA. A good example is the PE file or PE module for YARA. Using this, you can identify specific characteristics in a PE file in your rules. Things like PE section names or PE section length. These are deep characteristics in the PE file that it would be very difficult to write a rule to identify without the PE module. But keep in mind, when you use a module, the module must parse the entire file into the module format before the YARA conditions are run on the file. This means that by including a module, you are inherently slowing down the scanning by forcing that module to parse every single file that's being scanned by the rule. Now, in some cases, this cost trade-off is perfectly acceptable. Like I mentioned, finding deep characteristics inside of a PE header might be difficult just using conditions, and so the module is required. However, avoid using the module where you can use a condition instead. A good example of this is using the PE file isPE feature. So the PE module has a feature which will allow you to tell the YARA rule, is this file a PE file or not? Now, those of you who have worked with PE files before or YARA before will know that it's very easy to determine a PE file just based on the first two bytes in the file. I mean, of course, you can't validate that it's a legitimate PE file, but if you just want to have some sort of gated check to make sure it's a PE file, just check the first two bytes in the file. Don't use the PE module, right? So our advice is understand what you're using the modules for. If you can use a condition for it, it will be more efficient. If you're using a bunch of different features from the module, then go ahead and use the module. It's probably more efficient to use the module in that case. Now, our third and final consideration when writing efficient YARA rules is the order in which you create your conditions. So conditions have a short circuit feature, which means the first falsified condition will halt the scan. So what I mean by this is if you have a bunch of different conditions chained together, so for example, the file must have the string foo in it, the file must have the string bar in it, and the file must be of larger than 100 bytes. If you put the foo and the bar conditions first, then those conditions will be checked before the file size is checked. If you flip that around and you put the file size check first, then the file size check will ignore all files over a certain size and it won't check the foo and bar. Now again, referring to our very first consideration about strings, you can't short circuit the initial scanning of the strings by adding a file size unless you're using UNPACME.
UNPACME.
But more on that in a minute. So for normal rules, the condition short circuiting only applies once the conditions are being matched. So for a match of a string and a match of a file size, it's maybe not the best example because those are both pretty efficient. But consider a less efficient condition like a loop. If you have a large loop that is checking multiple things, that's inherently going to be slower than a file size check, or a check whether it's a PE file, or a check for a certain string. So you want to order your conditions in which the efficient ones or the quick ones will fail first and prevent the rule from having to do the more taxing conditions in order to determine there's no match. So just keep in mind the order of the conditions matters and to try and place your more efficient conditions first. All right, so that's our three main principles for writing efficient rules. There's one extra thing that we want to mention about UNPACME specifically.
UNPACME.
So UNPACME is our service that allows you to run your YARA rules across our malware corpus for free and both test your rules and scan for malware that you might be looking for. So the UNPACME YARA engine is compatible with the standard YARA engine, but there are some enhancements that we've made to the engine that are going to allow you to write even more efficient rules. The two main enhancements that you need to keep in mind are that in UNPACME, and only in UNPACME, we actually do take file size into consideration before scanning strings. So if you include a file size check in your conditions, we will check that first before scanning the file for strings. So file size checks actually matter quite a bit when running rules on UNPACME. In fact, you can get exponential increases in efficiency by using a file size check in UNPACME scans. The second thing to keep in mind is we have an automated tuning system called Scan Assist, which will take samples of files that have matched on your rule during the scan process and tune your rule to give you more matches while the scan is running dynamically. This is a service that we offer in UNPACME, and the goal is to drill deeper into the sample repository even if your rule isn't that efficient at the outset. Now, the algorithms behind this are kind of complex, and we're not going to go into it here, but a simple example that you can keep in mind would be if your rule doesn't specify a type of file, but during the scanning, as UNPACME is taking samples of the return results, it notices that you're only matching on .exe files. Then what it will do is it will tune the scan to only scan .exe files going forward. Now, of course, you have to be aware of this. There are certain cases where you might not want this to happen. There are certain cases where you might want your rule to run with no assistance at all. For example, if you wanted to just test the rule to see what it was actually returning. In that case, you'd want to turn off the scan assist. However, if you're hunting for malware, if you are using a rule to try and identify new malware or related malware samples to a sample that you're researching, scan assist is your best friend. It's going to help you drill deeper into the corpus with no added effort on your part. So just to recap, if you are running scans on UNPACME, add file size limits to your rule, as those will be checked before the rule is scanned, and use scan assist if you want to drill deep into the corpus and you have a rule that you may not think is too efficient and you want some assistance as it's running. All right, so that wraps up our tutorial series here. I hope you found this helpful, and I would encourage you to share your YARA rules with the 100 Days of YARA hashtag on X or Twitter, whatever you want to call it. Share them with us, share them on Twitter, share them on the Discord, get some feedback, and happy hunting. All right, see you later.